Welcome to the Science Industry Talk 2016. The Science Industry Talk is a joint initiative of the Austrian Federation of Industries and the Institute of Science and Technology Austria. Welcome. This year, it is a kind of specific claim we have put to the Science Industry Talk. It's new science, new business, and we would like to work on this through hopefully fruitful and interactive discussions. My name is Stefan Bernhard, and I will try to guide you through this evening, which will be at least logistically quite sophisticated, so whenever I'm lost, please help me in getting it fixed again. Since I'm just a moderator, you should also be aware of our host, and our host is our president. Tom, please come to me for your words of welcome.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Science Industry Talk 2016. New science, new business. We just talked about it. I really like this title, actually. It also puts the bar very high, so let's see if and hope the evening can live up to this expectation. I would first like to welcome Barbara Weidgruber, Director General for Scientific Research and International Relations at the Austrian Federal Ministry of Science, Research and Economy. I welcome our partners from industry, in particular Christoph Neumeier, the Director General of the Federation of Austrian Industries. And Helmut Mirnitsky, the CEO of EcoPlus, the business agency of Lower Austria, who represents here today Petra Bohuslav from the government of Lower Austria. I welcome the mayor of Klosterneuburg, Stefan Schmuckenschlager. All representatives of the government, of the civil service, of the Republic and of Lower Austria, all representatives of universities, of research institutes and funding agencies, without now individual names, but allow me to extend a very special individual welcome to Klaus Reidel, the chairman of the Board of Trustees of IST Austria. Finally, let me welcome all our esteemed panelists, and they will be then introduced individually later in the program. So in many ways, IST Austria pursues novel approaches, both when it comes to performing and managing research, but also when it comes to translating science to applications on and around our campus. This institute has many parallels to a startup. The way we grow, the emergence of new research fields, and a similar, often very entrepreneurial spirit on campus to approach problems, which is of particular importance for us because we are convinced that this spirit is actually the basis for many fruitful activities in technology transfer. And organized in cooperation with the Federation of Austrian Industries, this Science Industry Talk 2016 represents one of these entrepreneurial activities. It's done yearly, and it provides a forum to discuss ways on how to support the development of spin-offs, how to cooperate best with industry, and in general, how to build an innovative and exciting ecosystem for research. And I'm looking forward to a very interesting discussion today.
Thank you, Tom. Now I would like to ask Mr. Neumeier to join me on the stage in his function as Director General of the Austrian Federation of Industries. Please.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, also on my behalf, I would like to welcome you all at the Science Talk in 2016. We are delighted to have you here, and thank you for coming in such great numbers. As most of you know, the Federation of Austrian Industries has always felt a strong connection to IST Austria, from its foundation until this day, and it is a pleasure for us to carry out this event again as a joint cooperation. Let me firstly congratulate IST Austria. The result of this year's evaluation, which is carried out every 4 years, were extremely positive and concluded that the Institute of Science and Technology is on the right track to become an internationally recognized leader in basic research. This fact also finds expression in the high success rate of ERC grant applications and research awards received by excellent researchers of IST. In 2016, another scientist from IST, neuroscientist Peter Jonas, was awarded the highly prestigious Wittgenstein Prize, one of the most valuable science awards in Austria. The success rate of ERC grants is as high as 44%. That is more than 50% of IST Austria's external funding and the highest rate among large institutions in Europe, higher than Oxford and ETH Zurich. Moreover, the IST Austria 2015 annual report confirms the rewarding development of the institute. At this point in time, more than 580 employees from more than 50 nations work here, and IST Austria has generated more than 77 million euro in external funding from competitive research programs. These are impressive numbers for an institute whose campus, as we mentioned, Klaus Reidelt, opened only 7 years ago. Today's theme is new science, new businesses, as Mr. Hensinger mentioned. The IST is an excellent high-class international institute where new sciences are explored. And for the Federation of Austrian Industries, it is an outstanding honor to count Austria's top businesses to its members. From our point of view, it's crystal clear that only innovation and differentiation can lead to success and sustainable growth in Austria, particularly now while we face shorter innovation cycles and while we live during times of digitization. It is important to translate results of basic research to marketable applications even more quickly and to develop new business models for diversification. Consequently, close strategic and scientific cooperation between science institutions and businesses play a greater role than ever. Austria's particular strength has always been the production sector, about 20% share of GDP. And therefore, we have to explore new avenues for innovation, especially in that area. For instance, by taking advantage of opportunities generated by the digital transformation, which can offer highly sustainable, resource-efficient, and flexible production, and the possibility of developing new smart products and services. To conquer current challenges, we need to focus our support on our young professionals in developing their ideas and create space for creativity, thinking, and readiness to take risks. We must also strengthen STEM disciplines, as we call them in German, MINT Disziplinen, during all stages of the education system. Research-oriented competences need to combine with problem-solving capabilities, interdisciplinary and collaborative thinking and social skills. This combination, from our point of view, is the basis not only for a successful career in new sciences, but also in new business. However, new businesses also need entrepreneurial spirit and appropriate training. Thus, entrepreneurial spirit and education in schools, universities, and scientific institutions is a prerequisite. We believe this includes a focus on better infrastructure, personal flexibility, as well as supporting new ways of thinking. If we want to compete globally, we need to foster entrepreneurial skills, such as how to write a business plan or how to pitch an idea successfully. In this context, I want to underline the importance of supporting spin-offs. The IST has established a special program called TWIST to support researchers interested in the commercial development and use of their research results. Scientists and entrepreneurs are brought together to exchange their ideas and their experience. Moreover, the TWIST Fellowship Program was introduced, giving alumni and postdocs the chance to develop their own concrete product idea for a year after the competition of their academic program and meet with stakeholders and mentors during that time. Ladies and gentlemen, we appreciate such initiatives as they serve as an example for other scientific institutions and give young scientists the chance and the room to experiment and to create and concentrate on their own business ideas. We still need to keep in mind that in almost all cases, small, young, technology-driven and intensive companies need to rely on well-established companies and our investors to scale up their businesses successfully in Austria. Bigger established companies, so-called Leitbetriebe in Austria, for their part benefit from the flexible and dynamic structure of small businesses and new ways of thinking. Today's panel perfectly represents different perspectives of various players on innovative ecosystems and their cooperation. Though they are constructive dialogue, they contribute to successful brain circulation and the generation and maximization of know-how in Austria and across the borders. Ladies and gentlemen, I look forward to an exciting discussion, new ideas and cooperation to strengthen research, technology and innovation in Austria. A very warm welcome from our side.
Thank you, Mr. Neumeier. Now it's Mr. Minitsky, representing the state of Lower Austria, standing in for Mrs. Boslav. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, on behalf of our Minister for Economic and Technological Affairs of the province of Lower Austria, Dr. Petra Boslav, I would also like to wish you a warm welcome here at the IST Austria, and it's a great honor and pleasure for me to have or having the opportunity to be here to represent the state of Lower Austria and to present some highlights of the economic and technological strategies of the province of Lower Austria. First, technology, innovation and support of spin-offs. These are key elements of the Lower Austrian business and economic strategy. As it is mentioned in the invitation, of course you have seen it, the science industry talk this year, 2016, should provide a forum to discuss ways how to support the development of spin-offs, how to cooperate with industry, and how to build an innovative ecosystem. Tom Hensing and especially Christoph Neumeier explained the strategy and the opportunities and the vision of IST Austria. But we have another very good and excellent example in Lower Austria. These are our Technopoles, the Technopoles strategy, and I will come to common projects and common visions of the IST Austria and the state of Lower Austria a little bit later on. Technopoles, I hope you've heard the name of the Technopoles, stand exactly for the collaboration of technology, research, companies and education. It's a triangle, research, companies and education. Integrated in an innovative environment, the Technopole locations are managed by EcoPlus from the outset. Our Technopole manager, in every city we have one Technopole manager, are reliable partners to the researchers and the spin-offs at their Technopoles. Lower Austria currently has four Technopole locations where internationally recognized cutting-edge research is carried out. Our Technopole in Krems for biotechnology and regenerative medicine, the Technopole Tulln, not far away from here, for agricultural and environmental biotechnology, the Technopole in Wiener Neustadt, with the fields of, for instance, process technologies, medical technology, surface technology, of course, I have to mention here, Medaus Drone, the Cancer Institute, and the Technopole Wieselburg, our youngest Technopole, for bioenergy, agricultural, and food technology. In regards to locations in Lower Austria, I'm very pleased that in addition to those four Technopole locations, the location here in Klosterneuburg, Maria Gugging, will be further expanded with another planned technology center, which will result in the intensification of the synergy between the research at IST Austria and research-focused companies. Therefore, a new company of IST and EcoPlus has been established. Markus Wanko, the head of technology transfer at ISTA, is one of the two managing directors. The investment amounts totally approximately 15 million euros, around 2,500 square meters of leasable space will be available, and start of construction is planned for Q2 2017. Planned completion is in November 2018. So you see and you feel, I hope, our common energy and our common activities between the State of Lower Austria and IST Austria. At this point, Industry 4.0 should be also mentioned. In Lower Austria, this overview of the entire economy is being transformed from the topic Industry 4.0 to Economy 4.0 and Business 4.0, because Lower Austria entrepreneurial structure consists of 98% small and medium-sized enterprises. Lower Austria has three specific approaches in the topic of Business 4.0 to prepare companies, including some regional events, so that we really are active and bring our vision to all regions of Lower Austria. Prepare companies, support companies through a funding priority in the area of business, and of course, education and further training of workers. Here I also have to mention some further services of Lower Austrian public companies. For instance, Accent is a high-tech incubator for technology and innovation-driven startups. Technet Equity, Doris Agneter, the managing director of Technet Equity, is also here, is an Austrian venture capital fund investing in innovative high-tech startup companies with potential for significant growth. And last but not least, RITS. It's our agency specialized in full support services for startups and entrepreneurs. Last but not least, on June the 15th this year, 2016, our province of Lower Austria was presented with the European Entrepreneurial Region 2017 Award by the Committee of the Region, which shows, so it's our opinion, which shows the recognition Lower Austria has gained as a European model region in terms of business. So, Lower Austria is ready for the challenges of the future, and ladies and gentlemen, I finally would like to wish you, all of you, an interesting Science Industry Talk 2016, and thank you very much that I could present some parts of the Lower Austrian economy strategies. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Minitsky. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Paul Weitgruber, Director General for Research International Affairs at the Federal Ministry for Science, Research and Economy. It's my pleasure to welcome you here and ask you for your welcome words. Paul, please.
Distinguished guests, it's an honor and a pleasure for me to welcome you on behalf of the Ministry of Science, Research and Economy, the ministry which is in charge of providing the framework conditions necessary for IST Austria to play a key role, not just in Austria, but internationally as an institution of excellence in frontier research. It has been quite impressive to see a radical, innovative idea to turn into a success story, and at that time it was a high-risk idea for Austria. The Institute has grown and gained momentum year by year, as was already said by the President, and we can look back already at over 10 years of successful development made possible by a strong political commitment, a clear mission and strategy, a determined leadership, a rigorous implementation, flexibility and pragmatism, and also openness to adaptation. IST Austria shows that world-class research is possible in Austria and makes a strong and significant contribution to innovation and societal development. The two main objectives, which all of you know, of IST Austria are to perform world-class research in the sciences, but also to train the coming generations of leaders in science and research, but also in society. IST Austria has made valuable contributions to science and will definitely continue to do so. But we also have the young people, the PhD students and postdocs, which will continue to pursue their careers either in academia or in other parts of society, in Austria or in and beyond Europe. The IST Austria alumni will work in industry as entrepreneurs, in startups, in spin-offs, in the public sector, and in other parts of knowledge-driven societies internationally. IST Austria performance fits well in what the European Commissioner for Research, Science, and Innovation, Carlos Moedas, calls open innovation, open science, open to the world. You encompass all three elements. IST Austria has therefore also been an important partner for us when Austria, as the first country in the European Union, developed an open innovation strategy for Austria. This strategy is to open up, expand, and to further develop the innovation system with the purpose of boosting efficiency and output orientation. The Austrian Open Innovation Strategy, therefore, goes beyond addressing just the usual suspects, the business sector, from established companies to startups. It pays special attention to the need for a focused expansion of knowledge and innovation processes in science and research, in civil society, and in public administration and in politics as well. In July this year, the Austrian federal government also adopted a comprehensive startup package covering a period of 3 years and entailing a volume of about 185 million euros. This also includes a new academic fellowship initiative to support scientists and students with innovative ideas in their efforts to establish their own companies. However, IST Austria has already developed a comprehensive portfolio of activities to foster the entrepreneurial spirit on campus. And everyone who comes here quite often will realize that this is a very special spirit you have on campus. It has done so by having established a technology transfer office, by having launched the TWIST fellowship program, which was already mentioned, by having teamed up with EcoPlus, which was already mentioned as well, to create a technology park next to the campus of IST Austria, and by having filed the first patents. Today, we'll hear more about the activities, and we all look forward to hearing what it takes that this campus will become even more impressive as an innovation site for Austria, but also internationally. Thank you.
Thank you, Barbara. That was a perfect bridge for getting into discussion mode. It's my pleasure to introduce to you our expert panel. We'll be situated here, and I would like to ask the panelists to come to the table and enter discussion. Please welcome Burton Lee, lecturer at Stanford University School of Engineering. Welcome. Hello. Elisabeth Engelbrechtsmüller-Strauss, CEO of Fronius. Welcome. Georg Koppitz, member of the executive board of TT Tech. Welcome to IST. Peter Nussbaum, here you are. Managing director and head of medicinal chemistry at the Lead Discovery Center in Germany. And finally, Markus, where are you? Markus Manko, our head of technology transfer, please. Burton, you are a special guest coming from Stanford and knowing so much about the US innovation system, but also knowing a lot of details about the European innovation system. And we thought it would be the ideal way to kick off the discussion by asking you for an input statement and how you see the two spheres and how to compare them. So maybe I ask you for your input, which will be the starting point for discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Stefan. Is this microphone working okay? Yes. Well, actually, I'm not from Stanford University. I komme aus Graz, aus Steiermark, as you can see. This is my new Steirische Trachtenweste, which I bought in Graz 2 weeks ago when I was serving as a Gastprofessor with TU Graz with Rector Harald Kainz. And I'll tell you more about that engagement in a few minutes. Before we go on, can the students, researchers, PhD students raise their hands, please, here in the room? Okay, everyone please look around. Who are the most important people in this room today? It's those guys, okay? Because they're the future, they're the ones who are gonna be building companies. Let me ask you another question. Which organization today is responsible, single organization is responsible for the creation of more new startup companies worldwide than any other organization? Stanford University. Let me read you some recent numbers which were published in Crunchbase on TechCrunch. For 2016, the number of new funded startups that have Stanford University alumni or faculty as founders, this is up until last week, was 225 companies. Second place was MIT with 145. Third place was University of California, Berkeley, a state university with 115. Fourth place was, anyone guess? Harvard, 110, less than half of Stanford. Since 2012, the number of startups which have secured more than 10 million founders have come from which institution? And how many? Stanford, 420 companies that have secured more than 10 million. MIT, 269, Harvard, 251, Berkeley, 239. This is not about Stanford or MIT or Harvard, it's about the model. It's about putting universities at the center of the growth model of Austria, of Europe, of the world. And this is quite unique in the United States. Silicon Valley and Boston and Cambridge. Most of the United States does not have this model. The traditional model is universities en rente, at the edge, providing students a little bit of intellectual property, Forschung. It's very rare, it's a very unusual model to have universities such as Stanford, MIT, Berkeley, actually being drivers, direct drivers im Kern of Wirtschaftswachstum, creating new products, new jobs, new companies, hundreds per year. And since 1930, Stanford alumni, students, faculty have created over 40,000 new companies, are responsible for over $5 trillion in annual revenues globally, and over 3 million jobs globally. These are university-generated companies. So this is the power of the And the main lesson, in my opinion, from Silicon Valley is putting universities at the center of the economic growth model. And this is why, in my work across Europe, I work extensively across Europe. I lecture on European entrepreneurship and innovation at Stanford for 8 years now. I've lived in Europe, worked in Europe extensively for over 4 decades. This is why I'm very interested in visiting new universities, new university models, understanding them, understanding what's happening here, and this is why IST Austria is important, because it's a rare new model in Europe for university and how a university can contribute to economic growth. So it's very rare. You know, the only other major new models, you have the Finnish university reform from 2009, you have going back into the 60s, ETH Zurich, actually no, EPFL. EPFL was founded in 1969, but there are very, very few new universities being created across Europe. So this is an important development and project and experiment here. What is the point of creating lots of new companies and these institutions? So, wozu? Is it just about great science or is it more than great science? What are we trying to achieve with this? We're trying to achieve Wohlstand for our societies. We're trying to achieve quality of life for our people, jobs, self-esteem, pride, strength, economic competitiveness. okay? Respect. This is why we do this. It starts with science, excellent science, but it doesn't stop with science. Excellent science is necessary but not sufficient to achieve these goals. And so at the core of, I think, our question is, what is the mission of the university today? Is it just Forschung und Lehre und Bildung, or is it also a broader contribution? Is it economic growth? Is it economic development of the ecosystem? Our view from Stanford is that, of course, we are first and foremost an academic institution, but we also have responsibility to the community around us. And we view the community around us as being the world, starting with Palo Alto and Menlo Park first, of course. So in my work across Europe, in the last year, I've spent time in Stavanger, Norway. I'll be back there again tomorrow, doing an assessment of the Norwegian oil and gas-oriented innovation ecosystem. I've also spent time in the Ruhrgebiet doing similar assessments. I just completed an assessment for Steiermark and for TU Graz, where I recommended, well, first of all, I identified a very interesting emerging software and data cluster in Graz and around Graz that the leadership in Steiermark was simply not aware of. There are numerous new companies being formed. There are conferences attracting thousands of attendees around gaming. There are gaming hackathons going on. This is an emerging cluster which has not received the official attention at the Landesebene or in industry or in university. So my primary recommendation for Steiermark is that they recognize this emerging software and data cluster, but also begin to focus explicitly on software and data as a new competency, as a new cluster, as a new focus. I've recommended TU Graz establish a software and data campus, and that ICT entrepreneurship be the primary vehicle to building the Unternehmerische Universität, because software, fast-moving software teams, mobile app coding, programming, game design and development, this is how you build student engagement and interest fastest. This is how you create the largest number of new teams. This is how you build entrepreneurship culture inside the university and in a region most quickly. And then on top of that, on top of the university layer, we also, two Fridays ago, held a breakfast at AVL List, sponsored by Helmut List and Catherine List, to discuss with the industry leaders in Steiermark the creation of a new Steiermark Software Council to focus exclusively on software in Steiermark. Not IT, not microelectronic, not RFID, software and data only. Because such a platform does not exist today in Steiermark or across Austria. The software always gets mixed in with IT and the hardware. And they're going to do this. So I'm very optimistic. This is going to actually move across Austria. So what are some of the ways that IST thinks IST needs to think about as you move forward for the vision? Building innovation culture inside the university is extremely important. Student engagement is critical. We need the students, the research students, the PhD students, to be actively engaged in entrepreneurship, in creativity, in leadership positions, in organizing events, in hackathons. This is how you build culture. Culture is actually far more driven by student engagement rather than professor engagement. It's much more of a bottoms-up activity. And so getting, again, large numbers of students engaged is extremely critical. And not just students here, but connecting students here down at TU Wien, Hagenberg, TU Graz, around Austria is very, very important, building critical mass around software. Also, I think one of the things I think that needs to happen is the mix of research in Austria and across Europe needs to focus much more strongly on computer science. And I'm specifically using the word here, computer science, not informatik. You are facing perhaps Europe's greatest challenge today economically, because we are entering the new generation of artificial intelligence. AI is going to be everywhere, in your smartphones, in autonomous cars, autonomous trucks, autonomous vehicles, autonomous drones. And guess who are the AI leaders? Stanford, MIT, Cambridge, Carnegie Mellon, Berkeley, Which companies have the strongest AI departments? Facebook, Microsoft, Google, Salesforce, Oracle, General Electric. Which companies are buying up Europe's top AI startups? Microsoft, Google, Facebook, et cetera, et cetera. And Europe doesn't have a response, really, to the AI challenge out of the United States. And so, in my opinion, Europe needs to be investing much more heavily in computer science, not in heavily mathematics-oriented theoretical research, but in research that can lead to near and medium-term commercial applications. This is a big shift. Broadly speaking, Europe tremendously underinvests in universities, but computer science in particular needs to be strengthened because it is fundamental, not just as a discipline, but computer science and data are now becoming fundamental to the conduct of science in every single discipline, physics, chemistry, biology. It cuts across all the Fächer. And I'm concerned about the underinvestment in computer science broadly here in Austria and across Europe. So it is with these things in mind that I'm very encouraged by what I'm seeing here at IST Austria. I hope that these points will provide a point for discussion of the other panelists, I look forward to a robust debate. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Bert. Mrs. Strauss, coming from Fronius International, being CEO there. Fronius International being a highly acclaimed company, leading company in welding, charging, and solar energy solutions. Do you ascribe to all the quotes and all the statements of your speaker from Stanford, or would you say, well, given the background of my enterprise and you have 3,800 employees, you act on a worldwide basis, is it something you can relate to, or is that to say our ecosystem of innovation looks slightly different for many reasons?
As you gave me a briefing before this panel, you told me that Mr. Lee will say something very controversial.
Could be.
And I have something to argue against it. So unfortunately, that's not the point. I totally agree with him. Maybe talking about the background of Fronius, we are a company, it's not a startup, it's founded in 1945. So it was a startup, and we are very technology-driven company. So we were growing by ourselves, just by innovation. And I say it's not technology, it's innovation, and innovation is just something when it's also accepted by the customer. So we can have great ideas, which the people working in R&D like, but there must be behind a business model. Otherwise, it's for nothing, from my point of view. And just pointing out, innovative driven, we have an R&D department, and you already mentioned that at Fronius 3,800 people are working, and more than 450 people are working in R&D. So it's really, we are really very, very related on R&D. And in the past, we were very related on hardware. So we are coming from the hardware business. But in the last years, we employ over 90% software engineers. So the future, also for hardware-driven companies, is software. And there are issues which have to be solved just by software. So the hardware is necessary, but the business model behind enables the software. And for us, we are a company situated in Upper Austria, and it's really very hard to get good software engineers. So there's the Fachhochschule Hagenberg, which really does a great job, but and we really cooperate with them a lot, but it's not enough. And so I totally agree what you said. there we have really plenty to do.
Georg, coming from TT Tech, do you subscribe to there is a plenty of room for improvement in respect? And if yes, how could a company itself do something to counteract if some movements do not take place on a general level?
Yeah. First of all, thank you for being here. I know Bert Lee for a couple of years, and we had this discussion between the European and the US entrepreneurial system before. And I have to say, the Europeans are much better than they seem to be in many respects. Yeah. And we often underestimate the potential of our continent. I had to smile at the beginning when you talked about Styria and we talked about Lower Austria, and sometimes we are limiting a little bit our perspective to our local provinces here in Austria. I think we should look more on the strengths of the European continent. And if you quoted Microsoft, the second most common language within Microsoft is Romanian. They are hiring the good Romanian engineers with 17 years from the high school, give them scholarships to complete their studies in computer science, and then come back and join Microsoft. And we have been active in Romania since 2004 in the chip design team, and it's a splendid place to be there. Yeah. We made, about a year ago, we made a major investment in Serbia, in the city of Novi Sad, an old Austrian provincial town. We made an investment in a software company with 700 software engineers that are mainly working for those companies that you mentioned earlier on in the talks in the Silicon Valley and the Bay Area. You have to a little bit see it complete ecosystem. I'm happy that the Austrian Federation of Industries is here, because I think we do not have this kind of public companies like the ones you have in the Bay Area. Just to give you another data point, there are 3,000 publicly traded companies in the Bay Area. 3,000, and this is more than I think in most countries here in Europe. And so there is, of course, an issue we have in terms of ecosystem, in terms of, but we have a lot of good family-owned businesses. And we have got a lot of good institutions, and what we try to do, and it's also why I'm here, and thanks to Markus and Tom, is that we try to build networks and the bridges in the Austrian way or in the European way, which are somewhat not that fancy and that kind of spectacular, like the ones you read in the Wall Street Journal or in other magazines, but which are more kind of steady and very modest and also humble in terms of our industries we serve. Because Austria and Central Europe is the heartland of manufacturing. And as you mentioned before, software is now entering our manufacturing space, and software is now becoming the key competence in the industrial internet era and the area of networked machines. And I think we need to look how we can build those competences, but build them in a smart way and probably in different ways than our US competitors do it. Because if we just follow the way of Silicon Valley, we will be too late. Yeah. So we have to think, I think, into the future and see which are competences, capabilities, where the Europeans can excel. And how can we use IST and other different institutions here in Europe, where we have excellent engineers and excellent scientists, and how we can build the bridges between invention ideas and innovation and business. And I know this is where I very much agree with Burton. Because it's about innovation. Innovation is about solving customer problem and solving a need in the marketplace and finding somebody who is willing to pay for that. Yeah. And at the beginning we mentioned the great ratio of ERC grants here at IST, and I think it's perfect, it's wonderful, but it's public money, yeah? And somebody has to earn this money that we can spend then back in research. Yeah. In my opinion, we should look how can we create value to the customers, how can we create business value, and that's where I want to also invite all the PhDs to basically go across the bridge and join business and try to solve problems in the world where customers are willing to pay cash and money, and cash is the language of the business, and if you're not paid by the customer, you go out of business, and governments go out of money, and states get bankrupt. And I think we should a little bit focus more on the way of how we can earn money with value that we create. And I think software will play a key part, but we should not think about that we need to earn the money. And this is a little bit why I'm here. I think it's important that we build these bridges, that we, from the industrial, from the business side, tell to the science It's important that we have science, but it's important that people walk across this bridge and join our business community and really try to earn money from real business problems, which of course often are also science problems. But I think we should refocus on our strengths and also think of the European way.
Okay, thank you. Peter. Peter, you're managing director and head of medicinal chemistry at the Lead Discovery Center in Germany, representing life sciences, so to speak, on this panel. Does that also apply that business models get software-driven to life sciences, or would you say, well, we have to qualify that statement concerning life sciences as the area?
Yes, so I would say yes and no. The no is that, at least according to my experience, there are some major differences in the life science area. So particularly in the drug discovery and development field where I'm working. So a cycle time until you have something developed and it's mature for the market, it takes 12 to 15 years. So that's certainly longer to what we heard before. And the attrition rate, which means the success rate, but the attrition rate is quite high, which means that the success rate is quite low. So you start with many approaches only, and only a few will make it then to the market. But where I strongly agree is that the innovation potential has to be used, and particularly in my area, it's not really used. Yeah? So that's also why there is this lead discovery center. So lead is an expert term for what you could say it's a very crude prototype of a new drug. And so for drug discovery, for a novel successful treatment, you need two major ingredients. One is high innovation potential, which is usually lying in academia. And the second one is then the robustness in industry to make it to the product. And so in principle, it would be just very simple to mix these two ingredients. But unfortunately, in our areas, this is not as simple. There are many reasons, cultural differences, particularly incentive differences, and so on. And that's why the Lead Discovery Center is existing. So what we do is we collaborate very intensively with the academic group, with the academic inventors, to translate their innovative basic research findings into prototypes of new drugs. And if you do this in a professional way, if you use industry standard, high quality standards, then these prototypes can be commercialized. And that's what we do. And unfortunately, this application or bringing to application happens very rarely. And we would make for the benefits of the patients here a contribution. And I would like to encourage the young scientists in the life science field to go in this direction.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Markus, you kind of wrap up of this panel now, being a tech transfer officer at IST Austria. What are your major observations listening to the panelists, or what are your contributions, not only the observations?
A lot is happening in Styria, I guess. When we started this science industry talk, I think 5 years ago, and did it on an annual basis for the last 5 years, it was mostly us inviting people from somewhere else to talk about that the grass is greener somewhere else. And I'm still happy to listen to Syria, of course. But what we wanted to do this time really is to show the first seedlings of what we are doing here. And I think that IST is developing in a very positive way from a scientific point of view is I think, very much undisputed by now. And also think that building an ecosystem around it to make sure that technology transfer actually happens is not the very first thing that you can do before you actually have technologies to transfer. But I think by now we are in this phase where it's important that things happen, because building an ecosystem is is very much a cultural exercise as well. And culture takes time, and it hence makes sense really to start early, and I think influence the process as we go. And I think on that dimension, I have the feeling that we are doing the right things. And yes, it's first seedlings, but I think, as you will see today, there are examples of researchers that are doing work that is prone to translation and commercialization. That's one part. We managed to attract companies to come here and actually set up shop here, which is another dimension. And as a third dimension, we have graduates that are not only pursuing a scientific further career, but actually looking at industry to help exactly also what Georg and many of his fellow tech company heads, and obviously Ms. Strauss as well, are looking for. So I think, obviously, the numbers are not huge by now, and they can't be in the current situation, but the developments, I think, is right. I mean, some of the things that we mentioned before that we do is we make sure that people here get the opportunity to develop sort of their entrepreneurial side. And that's not something that you can obviously order people to do, but we're offering courses, we're inviting people to speak. We are just providing the opportunity for that. We have this fellowship program that was mentioned. We are in the process of setting up a little seed fund to provide funding for that. Not least, we are developing jointly with EcoPlus the technology park here, which obviously is concrete, I mean, in the material sense, and typically you say there should be ideas before concrete. I think there are ideas, and we have some firm tenants to be there, and you also need concrete. You need the physical space here as well, so I'm very happy, actually, for this development and happy that it will open in 2018. What do we do new? I was asked that before. And I'm not sure there is some, and I'm sure there is no magic that I can dispense here. But if I compare what we are doing with some of our peers, I think one of the differences that lies very much in the structure, I think, of IST is I think we have a pretty clear goal of where we want to go. And that was a goal that was already set out in the very beginning in the first report that was written about IST 10 years ago. Of building a top scientific institution with all the prerequisites it needs, but also embedded in an innovative ecosystem, attracting companies here, doing research that's also meaningful in industry, attracting companies here, making sure that our graduates also go out and do industry jobs. All that is not new, but was written down 10 years ago. So I think the goal is clear, and what makes us maybe a little bit different is that in the way how we pursue this goal, we are, I like to say, I'm not sure everybody in the front row in our president agrees, no, I'm sure he will, is we are very pragmatic about how we want to go there. We are pragmatic and quick. I think we can take decisions very quickly. I think we have a structure that allows to do that. And many of the things that have happened over the last 2 years, I think, were possible because of that feature.
Thank you, Markus. Since time is a little bit precious, I would like to bring this panel for the moment to an end and move on to a little bit of a video we prepared, where I think some things are illustrated very well, what Markus just described, that IST is a curiosity-driven research institute, but there are people who, by doing so, by doing their creativity in research, produce rooms or ideas where commercialization is possible. And maybe we can have that video as an intro to the next panel.
We are interested in studying neurodevelopmental disorders, such as autism, epilepsy, and intellectual disability. And what we do exactly is to try to identify molecular and genetic bases to understand the pathophysiology behind those disorders. And of course, the final goal would be also to be able to identify possible therapies for those pediatric disorders. And of course, I cannot say that they want to treat autism in general, because probably 500 to 1,000 different forms of this specific condition. But our aim is to identify molecular targets for subgroup of autism or epilepsy or intellectual disability that eventually could give rise to the identification of novel treatments.
I'm interested in fluid turbulence, and large part of our work is trying to figure out how turbulence first arises in our experiments. If you look at fluid flows globally, we spent about 10% of the electric energy on pumping fluids around, and if we could entirely avoid turbulence, we could save around 90% of these losses, and so we could, you know, save roughly 9% of the global electricity consumption. I'm normally not at all interested in applications. In this case, it's a bit of an exception, because this application is connected to a very interesting fundamental question as well. If we learn how we can avoid and get rid of turbulence, we also understand something about the conditions that turbulence requires in order to be sustained. And this is quite a deep fundamental question that we are after.
The topic of our research is to employ the power of light to understand and manipulate cells. We do that in the cells that are involved in Parkinson's disease and in diabetes. And in particular, we would like to understand how these cells talk to each other.
The applications are based on the great features of light, because light is very cheap and very fast, and also it goes very far. And in the past years, we developed different methods to use light, for example, to find new drugs, but also to protect cells from being degenerated in diseases like in Parkinson's or Alzheimer's or diabetes.
So we are basic researchers, but it nevertheless makes us very happy and very proud if some of our results can be returned to the community that supports us in doing our research.
So my research area is computer graphics and computational fabrication, and our goal is to come up with novel representations and algorithms that allow designing, simulating and fabricating functional objects using computer-controlled output devices, such as 3D printers, for example. So I think in general, computational fabrication will in the future revolutionize how we distribute, design and also fabricate products. And we do basic science here, but I believe that our algorithms will empower engineers and designers in the future for very interesting applications in the area of, for example, customized products or medical implants, or for designing robotic parts or in nanofabrication. I mean, of course, as a scientist, I'm primarily interested in having a profound impact in science. But then, on the other hand, I'm also very much interested in actually having an impact on society. You know, seeing our basic algorithms being applied is, of course, a very rewarding experience.
Please welcome Gaia Novarino, Bernd Bicky, Björn Hof, and Harald Janowiak, our IST professors today. So we thought we'd produce a video in order to get the message across what you do scientifically in a nutshell. In case you're not, or you want to still comment on that, please do so. But I would like to start with Bernd and saying, you made a clear point saying I'm a fundamental researcher. I'm interested in fundamental questions. Does that sound a little bit arrogant, or is that a clear division of labor you see and where you can be most effective in?
Of course, the basic mission of our research institute is to do basic science. And in terms of the research questions we're looking at, I mean, we're selecting them based on curiosity. But I'm a computer scientist, and there, as pointed out before, this discipline is an important foundation for many application areas. And so one cannot really, you know, very strictly separate actually basic research and applications. It's definitely always a mix that comes together, and these
basic research questions actually fuel very interesting applications in the future. I think, you know, these two things actually go together. Also in our area, I think it's actually much, much harder to come up with a research project that doesn't have any application in the future at some point. So in that sense, I wouldn't, you know, try to draw this distinction too hard.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Gaia, being a neuroscientist, to me it appeared that you're kind of mission-driven. You want to start with laying the foundations for a future cure. Does that imply that the work you do is driven by that mission entirely, or are you ready to accept new ways, new directions as well?
Well, no, it's also, I mean, we are curiosity driven as well, right? So we are also doing basic research, and so this is one of the fundamental aims of our lab is to understand how the brains work in general. But I also felt always this role in the society, so that as a scientist, I just don't have to accomplish my own curiosity, but also to accomplish something that is useful for the mm-hmm. others. And so I feel a bit this mission about identify something that someone else can use.
And do you share the perspective with the other neuroscientists here? Do you think that this is a common mindset?
Well, I think that others may are more curiosity driven than I am. I mean, I'm very basic neuroscientist, but definitely I am the most applied or close to applications among the neuroscientists here. But in the other side, knowledge, so basic knowledge of the brain or how the brain works, will also lead to novel approaches in terms of therapies of different disorders and helping other people. So at the end, is just about how we approach and how we are phrasing the question, rather than exactly how which will be the outcome. Because I'm pretty much sure that the outcome of all the research of all the other neuroscientists have also mm-hmm. Can also bring to important applications.
Thank you. Björn, you're the Mr. Flow. Whenever you're in the flow, Björn must be involved somehow. You said in the video you see this room for applications, but you personally are driven by the most fundamental questions in finding algorithms and things like this. How do you treat your coworkers, your team members, when they approach you with questions whether to go this direction or that direction? Application-driven or more curiosity-driven?
Okay, my research group, I think I give a lot of freedom to all the members of my group, and I'm also very happy if some of them, and I have several engineers actually also in my group, so it's a mix between very fundamental people like from physics or mathematics background, but all the way to engineers. Oh. And you know, if the engineers are more driven by applications, then I'm also happy to support that. There mm-hmm. is no question about that. Just personally, I mean, I try to understand basic, simple questions about nature, let's say, and we mostly working on turbulence. But on the other hand, it's not a negative thing that we are, you know, interested or that I am interested in fundamental questions. So if we make a big step in answering one of these fundamental questions, there should be, in an ideal case, very many applications that result from that. So I'm not the one who's going to pursue all these different directions, but you know, I'll pass on the knowledge, hopefully, and then others who are more driven by applied things, and these may be my students, can continue that.
There's nothing as powerful as strong theory, and nothing as practical. Harald, you work in a field that actually carries a lot of potential, at least the people would see it that way. Could you briefly describe, because you have had first experiences with using the tech transfer system at IST Austria for filing first patents. Could you briefly describe what you do and how you deal with it on a personal level?
Yeah, I'll be happy to do that. I think one strength we have at IST, since you brought our technology transfer up, is we have what you call in German kurze Wege, right? I mean, I think on the stage it's maybe 5 meters, but actually in reality it's 5 meters as well. And I think many of you will probably confirm that. And the other points Marcus brought up already, I think we have flexibility and we can decide quick. And I think this is a fairly unprecedented situations. When I go to a conference and I talk to colleagues, they are actually always very jealous of how things work here in with respect to, for instance, our technology transfer office.
And what about the patents you have already filed? Could you describe what it's all about?
Sure. So maybe I can connect a bit to what Gaia said. I mean, the way I was raised as a scientist was first, it's a privilege to be a scientist, right? And second, it's a responsibility, right? So you do that because you're curiosity driven. But if there is an opportunity to return to society, you should actually really do that because it is a privilege, and society supports us. You've seen the video, and essentially what we do is we try to find new ways to identify drugs, and we also try new ways to cure diseases. And the common component is that we use light. So we use light as a new tool to find drugs, and it's a new tool to cure diseases. And we have been quite fortunate that both of these research tracks have yielded to something that we could discuss and follow up with our colleagues from the Technology Transfer Office.
Marcus.
If I get praise like this, I feel there is something unpleasant coming around tomorrow morning. But actually, I mean, I wasn't thinking of this, but the panel here is a really good representation, I think, of the different disciplines. And if you think through what a spin-off in these different disciplines actually means, you see how different the type of work is that we are doing. In Bernd's group, it could be one guy, a postdoc, a PhD student, who has an idea and takes an algorithm and builds a company around this, right? In Björn's context, we are talking about hardware that would work as implants and inserts in pipelines, which is a processing industry topic where you need to convince pipeline operators to changing the setup of the system. It's a quite different challenge. If you look at what Harald and Gaia are doing, as biologists and neuroscientists, that's the very first bit, and maybe Peter, you can come in on this, the very first stretch in a very, 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 very long development until there is actually a product. I think one of the also great discussions we had before this panel here is how can we interact with other institutions, because what's really clear to us is that we don't have it all and we don't know it all. We know that we need to partner with people, and that's nowhere more evident than in this area, right? I mean, our biologists would sort of in the best of situations come up with an understanding of a biological pathway and with a target. We don't have medicinal chemistry in here to make sure that we actually find compounds that then work with this. And this is where I'm glad that we can work on the basis we do with you.
Yeah, so maybe a few more comments. I mean, I was impressed by all 4 contributions, but I can only comment on Gaia's and Harald's. Again, these are 2 examples of excellent basic research, and I have been discussing with them their results, and I'm deeply impressed. And I think that it could be a real contribution, as Gaia mentioned, to the society back if a drug is discovered out of their research. I mean, that's really something you can bring back to the people who fund you. But still, as Marcus just said, they have been working for years on this, but still it's not clear if one or the other can make it, will make it. So that's in the life science areas, this long development cycle, and we have not yet started really the discovery phase. Yeah? And it needs now additional skills and manifold skills and so on. And I think what we try to do at the Lead Discovery Center, and that's also my motto, yeah, it's not now to identify the weaknesses here, and shouldn't they be better in doing robust assays or whatsoever? No. They should keep on what they can do best. So it's, for me, the motto is combining the strength. Yeah, combining the strength in their teams, in their research, with the industrial application. And unfortunately, as you can see from these long development times, it needs also quite a bunch of money. And this is additional money. So this cannot be taken from the research budget. So this would be a big mistake. Yeah? So it would need an additional translational fund. I mean, there is now an Austrian initiative ongoing, so I hope the very best that this can be really successfully started and also funded well, because if it's understaffed, you better should not start. But now coming back, so I think these are extremely good examples, but still way too early to say one or this is better. So you have to start with both in parallel, and then the experiments at the end will tell you, yes, I have reached the next milestone or not. So it would be good if you have additional skill set from outside, from wherever. I think you're planning to collaborate with the SEM and so on, and we interact. So that's the way to go. But as I said, it would need quite some money in addition. So I'm happy to hear about the technology park, but also for the project, it would need some financing.
Okay. Now looking at the time again, I'm leaving the table of fee for ERC grantees, by the way. So maybe that also illustrates the strength of the Institute scientific-wise. Bernd and Gaia this year, congratulations again. And I move now towards the next table, where we look at examples of Austrian alumni, IST Austria alumni, who made the step from academia into industry. Because IST Austria's strength, thank you very much, by the way, IST Austria's strength will not only be measured by scientific accomplishments, but also by the impact our alumni will have in their future careers. And we are very happy to welcome today three of them who decided to move out of academia towards industry. I'd like to welcome Martin Kmelik, Alexander Eichner, and Stefan Huber to join me here on the table so that we can chat what you're doing right now and what your future perspectives look like. Welcome. Well, I would like to start with you, Martin. Microphone is here. Welcome back.
Thank you.
You left IST Austria not that long ago. You were a group member of Krishnendu, Jet to Cheese group, right?
Right.
Yeah. And you graduated in 2016, and your boss is sitting over there.
Right.
I won't ask you how TT Tech works from the inside point of view, because that would be simply not fair. But how actually did you decide to move from IST Austria to TT Tech? How did you get into contact, and how did you decide to join TT Tech and what you do there actually?
Right. So I've graduated from IST Austria in the beginning of this year, and I've joined TT Tech Labs, which is a research group inside TT Tech 5 months ago. So basically, like the decision for me to join TT Tech was probably coming from a project I was doing at IST, where in the end we were actually using some algorithms we have developed to control a quadcopter, and the quadcopter was not doing anything fancy; it was just like flying around in rooms, fulfilling some goal. And I was thinking it's very rewarding actually to see something moving out of my work. And you probably all know that TT Tech is actually building devices that are flying in planes nowadays, in cars, in space. And I was thinking this is a very exciting opportunity for me to actually participate and do some work that maybe one day possibly could be deployed in systems like these.
And by the way, you actually have to do research with big players in the field. I mean, the customers and clients of TT Tech, that reads pretty impressive. No, not too many people know that, but basically that is really your work, top tier industry-wise, right?
Right. I was actually surprised by the number of connections TT Tech is having and the projects that are running with universities around Europe and companies around the world. So actually the transition for me was kind of smooth, because I'm actually now in the projects I'm working on, I'm meeting people that I already knew from academia, which I was surprised by.
Okay. Alexander, different field, a little bit different background. Now you work for a European-German patent attorney candidate, actually for Grund Intellectual Property Group in Munich. And you actually have a life science background. You worked as a postdoc with
PhD
student with Michael Sixt. Yeah. Could you shortly, briefly explain what you do right now and how that happened that you took that path to patent attorney candidate?
Yeah. So as you just said, I have a background in biology because I used to work with Michael Sixt, and I graduated in 2013 or end of 2013. And then I decided actually to switch the field, and now I'm actually working at the interface between research and industry, which is kind of really exciting and important because I think to get those, first of all, to identify innovations in between the research is one of our goals, and actually to protect them by intellectual property rights. Mm-hmm. Because otherwise, I think it will not attract industry.
You come from the life sciences. Now you work in a field where you have a lot of legal constraints to observe. How do you deal with that? Is that part of your job, actually, or is that just a little episode that you have to cover?
It's both. I have to deal with questions of patent law and also general law, actually. But I'm also confronted with a lot of, let's say, technological questions which I have to answer and which I have to problems I have to solve, actually. And I think the interdisciplinary environment of IST kind of really helped me to get a really broad technological background, and which now allows me to promote and support the protection of technological inventions in a very broad field.
When you look back at IST Austria times, how did you perceive that? What were your, when you talk about IST Austria with friends and talk it over, how did you experience the time at IST Austria?
Yeah, it was really exciting, first of all, because I think I was one of the first experimental scientists here at Austria, and I think one of the first 50 scientists, and it was kind of really exciting to see this institution growing and developing, and this is something which is really exceptional.
Mm-hmm.
And
okay, Stefan, again a little bit of a different background. Stefan, you worked in Herbert Edelsbrunner Group, that is somewhere in the interface between mathematics and computer science, I would say. Maybe if Herbert would be here, he would correct me, but I don't know. You work now for an engineering company, electrical engineering company. Could you briefly describe what you do and how you actually decided to joined that company?
Yes, exactly. So I'm working for a company, Bernecker & Reiner, B&R. It's in automation industry. So it's a company with approximately 3,000 employees. So it's a significant player in automation industry. It's a company from Upper Austria. And so my background is I have a double degree in mathematics and computer science, and did a PhD in computational geometry, and it's kind of funny because at first it's not quite clear what I should do with my background in the company doing selling hardware, right? and building up control systems and building up, I don't know, motors, electrical motors, right? But there is a huge shift from electrical construction or selling hardware to also selling software, right? So in the past, all the costs in order to develop software were kind of merged into the hardware price, mm-hmm. but I guess this is now starting to diverge. So what I'm doing there is I had the luck to join the company at a time when they were kind of kick-offing a new R&D project. And this project This project, so I'm from the motion department, so I'm dealing with moving parts. So the most prominent example would be a robotics, right? Multiple axes moving the so-called the tool center point of a robot around and grabbing stuff and putting it somewhere else. So this new project is gives a huge degree of freedom to the people who are designing machines, so from the machine construction's point of view, and puts in challenges from logistics, optimization, motion planning, and so on, similar to robotics, but different. And by that challenge, there are a lot of problems from computer science and mathematics. And that's probably why when we look at the PhDs in our company, then the PhDs below some certain age are PhDs from electrical engineering, and the new ones are from computer science. Yeah, so it's exactly what you said. I'm observing in my company at home. Yeah.
Okay. Looking at you, you went out from IST because it is planned that way. It is clear that PhD students and postdocs leave IST Austria a certain period of time, and you decided to go for industry. And obviously, when listening to you, you do not regret that decision at all. It's just a very enriching experience, I would say, right? Looking back at IST Austria, just a short note on that, we will try to stay in contact with our alumni much closer in the future than we did in the past, because our number of alumni is growing. And we think that good alumni relations will be one of the key success factors to demonstrate how our alumni do. And it's great to have you here. And I think a big hand for alumni stepping out of academia into business. Now, I'm moving to the last empty table, and that is the fourth panel we plan, and that is about our avant-garde in terms of entrepreneurial spirit here on campus. IST Austria is about to build an IST park as a joint venture with EcoPlus. Despite the fact that we have virtual ideas about this IST park, we have already physical tenants here, and it's a great pleasure to have our representatives from the companies here. I'd like to welcome all three of them today. I'd like to welcome Mark Laws, Christian Pavlou, and Roland Zeilinger, please. Mark, may I start with you? You're managing director of W2P, Way to Production Engineering. Could you briefly describe what your business is all about and why you decided actually to come here on campus and do the business here?
Yeah. So we are developing and manufacturing 3D printers for the special focus area of medical applications, which means for dental applications, so printing ground and bridges, splints, etc., and also for applications for the hearing aid industry, for example, Austrian company called Neurot is one of our biggest customers. this company was founded back 2.5 years ago, which is was a spin-off of the Technical University of Vienna, and we were a bit like Apple Inc. in the good old times. We were screwing, assembling our printers in the cellar in the 3rd Vienna district, and we had some 3-4 employees, and finally decided to grow. And by accident, we found Marcus, who decided to acquire us to locate to Maria Gugging. And I think it happened to you the same or similar way. And the main reason really is that we wanted to team up with a university. So one of our competitors, which is also a Vienna-based 3D printing company, teamed up already with the Technical University of Vienna. And we believe that we found here a good location, how we or that we can team up with Institute of Bernd and the others. And we also applied for the COMET project together. And also, the IST campus provides us flexibility. So we came with 5 employees. We are now heading to 15. We want to grow for another to a maximum of 25 employees. And I think the teaming up, so finally we will be an R&D company. We will design 3D printers. We will build the prototypes by ourselves, but we will then outsource the production to a sub-supplier. So meaning that's our business model. So we want to keep staying as a R&D company, and that's the perfect environment for us in the future.
Do you also use, or do you intend to use parts of the infrastructure that's available in Institute, because it is organized in a way that this is possible on a commercial basis? Is that part of
that's a second issue, yes, right? There's a machine shop here as well, which we would like to use in future time for our prototyping activities.
Mm. Okay. And do you get a little bit of the atmosphere here that academia is at your fingerprints, so to speak? Is that something that you experience when you work here on a daily basis, or is it something that is not 100% the case?
Yeah. We are just moved in April, right? So we are very much working with ourselves to optimize our product, right? But we've been also successful already, so we got one of Björn's employee from his institute who's just started last month as a top engineer in our team, which is also a big, big benefit, right, to network here with the different institutes, etc. And the spirit is very international and very cool, and it's different to the third Vienna district, where only tourists are around.
Okay, thank you. Christian Pablo, you're a CEO of Crystalline Mirror Solutions, and as far as I know, Crystalline Mirror Solutions is a typical offspring of basic fundamental research with a strong connection to quantum physics at the University of Vienna. I saw Mr. Aspermeyer somewhere over there. Hi. So I think there's a strong connection. Maybe you can briefly describe what the background of your company is and what your business case is.
Yes, absolutely. So Crystalline Mirror Solutions makes the world's best mirrors. It's a strong name. Best in the most relevant dimensions, of course. So our mirrors are used for the world's most precise optical clocks, for researching gravitational waves, and for precise detection of little traces of molecules, parts per billion, parts to trillion, traces that you need in medicine, in security, in industrial surveillance. Our company, as you said, is a spin-off of the University of Vienna, and basically the grounding or the founding myth of CMS is that Vienna quantum optics met Silicon Valley material science. So basically Marcus Aspermeyer tried to solve a scientific problem, and he hired a material scientist from California who came to Vienna, and then in a nuclear fusion event, the best mirrors of the world came out of that. So the company was founded end of 2013, September 2013. Basically, we could celebrate our third anniversary. We are headquartered in Vienna, but in the same month, we already founded our subsidiary in California, in Santa Barbara. So we have 12 employees now. It's a little bit like the Empire of Charles V, where the sun never sets, because we have 9 time zones in between. And to make it not too simple, in May, we also founded a branch office in Zurich, Switzerland. And now, the plan is, since we also stumbled into Markus Wanko, to basically move our Austrian site to Kloster Neuburg, And the reason for that is, let's say, twofold. So there's a very practical reason. You know, I'm responsible, you know, to keep the company alive and to look at the numbers. And, basically, the reason here is that there is a very, very high flexibility to get here and to use the environment. We will build on the great material science footprint that is here. We will use the clean room. We will use lab space here. Office space, of course, and that is pretty unique, you know, that we can have all of this in, I would say, really, I mean, top quality at the same location. The other reason is that, you know, for us, it is essential to be grounded and to have the connection to science and, you know, to have the exchange of our people with the scientists who are here. I'm really very, very much looking forward to this. Because I personally think that the boundary that sometimes is seen between basic science and between industrial research is a bit artificial. I mean, we live in a world, you know, where 4 out of 5 euros that are spent on research and development are spent by private companies. Yeah? So, you know, we try to be one of them. Right now, you know, we are spending more than 50% of our revenues on R&D. This is possible because we live, you know, in a great Austrian environment where we also get, you know, some leverage and some subsidies and so on. This, yeah, otherwise this would not be possible. You know, maybe one last anecdote. Yeah, you know, why I or what we try to do. You know, our mission is, you know, to provide the world with great mirrors. Our vision is, you know, to tear down these frontiers between, let's say, academic research and industrial research. So when I was a student in Freiburg, I was lining up at the cafeteria behind two professors. You know, I was standing there with my tray, and they were standing there with their trays. And then they were obviously talking about an PhD student, a grad student. And one was asking the other one, how is Thomas doing? And the other said, he's dead. I said, oh my, I didn't know. Nah, he's joining a company. it's our vision that these conversations do not happen in the future.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. Roland Zeilinger, you have been the first tenant. You are CEO of Prime Aerostructures. And could you briefly describe what you do and what are the reasons or were the reasons to come here? And maybe we get to a different point a little bit later, please.
Yeah. So, welcome. My name is Roland Zeilinger. I'm the owner of Prime Aerostructures. Prime Aerostructures is a company that provides engineering services to the aerospace industry. My personal background is aerospace from the very beginning. I worked actually in Seattle, San Diego, Toulouse, and Bremen. So you know the big players which are located there. And then I worked also for all the larger Austrian aerospace companies. I was chief engineer of product development at FACC, which is a large upper Austrian company for composite materials. And I was head of design organization for Diamond Aircraft, building the entire aircraft. So what we do here is, and I actually founded a company 7 years ago, and all my former employers are now my customers. And what we do is we do a lot of simulation design for aerospace components, like either entire structures of airplanes or components, just like thrust reverses on the Boeing 787. Just recently, we did the analysis for the A330neo fan cowls, which is the part of the engine that covers the large fan. And for smaller airplanes, we work like on a new airplane from Diamond, which is the DA-60. It's a single engine turboprop aircraft, and we did the entire design of the wing. It's an all composite wing, no fasteners, all bonded. And with all this, we started our discussions, and we do all our work just in the digital area. And so when we started doing more parts and more components, we also were thinking about we need to produce something. And then we started discussing with the IST project, which is related to 3D printing. And we are now project partners, like in the same project as Mark and groups from the IST, which deals with the technology around 3D printing, especially development process and the mathematics before you actually create a part. this was one of the reasons moving to the IST. The second reason, and maybe some of the people in the room know me, I'm actually born in Klosenavik and I live here for almost all my life. And so we started our company in an office building more in the downtown area, and that was a rather old building. And so we were offered to move to this new science technology park, which will be built. And in the meantime, we are now in one of the lab buildings. Actually, we moved in just 3 days after the lab building was opened. And this is, for me, very important as a person. So and to actually support Klosenavik and the IST to get some more other companies into this town. And this is one of our main drivers to actually move to the IST. Mm-hmm.
When you listened, for example, to our expert panel, are there any observations you'd like to share or say, well, I see it slightly differently?
Actually, it's really funny when we're talking about software and the company that we run is rather small. It's also only 12 engineers, but we already have a really, and we are partner of a company in the US, in Providence, Rhode Island. It's Dassault Systèmes Simulia. And this is a company that develops software for simulation that we also use. And we also have software currently working, which is not commercially available and will be available. It's especially software for simulating the 3D printing process, actually. So we are now in an area where we're not just simulate the final part and we get some loads on there and see how it behaves. We're actually now the entire simulation change that we're now starting simulating the part from the very beginning, when you really produce the part until basically end of life of the part. And by doing this, we actually teamed up rather fast with Bernd's group. And there's, it's now a project, it's not even a project, we just did it together. where we starting using, instead of using virtual reality, which you now can play on PlayStation 4, we're now going into the area of augmented reality, which means that you actually augment the real picture, the real surrounding with digital information. And this is for us very important because we want to have 3D reviews of the components that we're doing in a full-scale size of the part inside a room or inside a hangar, augmenting this digital hologram with the real aircraft, for instance, and see how this part will look like on the real aircraft or how this part will perform on this real aircraft. So we're now getting more and more in the area where we actually also use the information of the simulation into holograms and so on. And this is purely software engineering that needs to be done. We are engineers, we are not software engineers, and we are not really computer scientists, and this is the reason why we now want to get more involved with the groups here on IST.
And obviously distance matters in that context. When you have your collaborators next door, it makes a difference.
Actually, this is real nice, so Bernd is just above me. So if we need to talk, we do this, there's not even a meeting scheduled. We just talk on the floor and see how it works, and we share our ideas. And you know, I think we have to define a real project in the near future. But right now, it works that way pretty well.
Yeah.
Well, our expectations are high. So in Santa Barbara, at our US subsidiary, we are using a clean room that belongs to the UCSB, and we're sharing this with companies, for example, like Google. And out of that came now a joint collaboration project with Google. So, well, as I said, you know, the bar is high now for the IST, yeah, what comes out here.
Well, that's a challenge I think we would like to take on. By the way, the reason why we can offer clean room facilities, for example, is that we pull together the infrastructure as core infrastructures that is made available for all faculty on campus, but also on commercial terms for tenants. That means we have a very clear system how that can be employed in a way either academically or for tenants in their business model. And by the way, the approach we have at IST Austria is to be just as good as the best places in the world. So let's try that. Thank you very much. As our tenants, you are already here because it's definitely true that IST Park is still a project. It's still in the making, but we're confident that this project will elevate. And we decided, as a kind of wrap-up of this science industry talk, to have a kind of sneak preview, what we called it, Markus, on what is going to happen with the IST Park. And you, as first tenants, might also have a look at it. And now, logistically, either you move forward and have a look at the presentation as a panelist, or you just turn around and see what is going to happen. Please, Mr. Schaffer.
And while Mr. Strehov sets up his shop, let me say one thing. I'm very happy and glad for the three of you to be here. Christian, particularly also with your spirit, and what I heard liked most about what you said before is the Charles V Empire thing, because the sun never sets, right?
Okay, Mr. Strehov, the floor is yours.
A few words and a few slides to the new IST technology.
It should be on.
Technology park. In 2013, the European-wide competition started. In 2014, IST Austria made another right direction and we won the competition. In 2015, we started with the master plan. And in 2016, we work on the planning for the next part. Next slide, please. No, this one, okay. What was our briefing? IST said to us, we need a place for spin-offs, corporate and cooperative research and development adjustment to IST Austria campus, developed by a joint venture between EcoPlus, Lower Austria's business agency, and IST Austria. We need a flexible use, office, various labs and clean room configurations, modular development, construction in line with actual demand, innovative office layouts allowing for cooperative and individual work, and of course, at a cost budget, consumer rate with the public developer. Next one. So, what was our design? It was based on the idea to arrange the building along the contour line of the hillside, this side. Each building has a direct access to the garage, and the entrance to the garage is on this side in the Hinterstorfer Straße. Next one. The building's width is 22 meters, which is the optimal for a flexible use of the buildings. So we can make only offices, or only labs, or clean rooms, or the different types with offices and clean rooms, or different units. It's everything is possible, and in the middle zone, we have on this side, and on this side, we have the shafts. Next one. In the phase one, which is now, we are building these two buildings. They have a net area with 5,300 square meters, and all buildings together in the end, we will get about 26,000 square meters. Next one. All buildings will get a rain screen terracotta cladding facade. This is the building one, which is the main building. Next one. This is the second building. And at the end, you can see a few images. Next one. The building one. The work will start in 2017 and it will open at the end of 2018. Next one. And the last one. Thank you.
Okay. So that is the rendering of the IST park. Thank you, Mr. Schreihoff. We also plan to have interaction with you as the audience. I would like to do that despite the fact that time has really almost elapsed. We had a lot of input from our panelists. Thank you very much for all your input you gave from different perspectives. Are there any questions, any specific questions you'd like to ask our panelists here in the auditorium right now? Yeah, we have a question over here. Lisa?
Yeah, I'm not okay.
Try it like this, okay.
So yeah, to Mr. Lee, something you said in the beginning, namely you want to push computer science, and I guess you mean software engineering, as opposed to informatics. I don't really understand, because are you afraid that there will be too much academic manpower and they're not doing relevant stuff? Or, I mean, I think the parts of informatics, which is too theoretical to be applied in the next 3 years, is not such a huge part of the university campus to, I mean, actively push in another engineering direction.
Perfect.
So the work I do across Europe, I see huge gaps between industry needs for IT and software people, software engineering, and huge underproduction of software engineers out of the informatics faculties. You see this in Germany particularly, where, for example, at the Ruhr Universität Bochum, where I was earlier this year, 42,000 students, they produce less than 200 computer engineers, software programmers, for the entire Ruhrgebiet, which has hundreds of Mittelstand firmen who cannot find enough software people. And if you take this across Europe, so the gap in, so the Lücke in software engineer IT Fachkräfte is about 500,000 people, I've been told, all across Europe. One of the important reasons this is happening is because the informatics faculties are simply not producing, they are refusing to produce software engineers and are instead focused on theoreticians, mathematicians.
So are you saying 4,000 people, the other 4,000 are going into academia and only 200 are writing code?
So the informatics, I'm speaking specifically at the Ruhr Universität Bochum, they're producing theoreticians around Informatica who go into academic positions for the most part. Not into industry positions, because they're graduating from RUB, they cannot code. I mean, you find informatics faculties all over Europe, Germany, other countries, producing informatica who cannot code. Okay, write software programs, you know, at a commercial level. This is simply not acceptable any longer.
Okay, does that answer your question to some? Okay. Other addition? Sorry,
may I add?
Sure.
So it's funny because I discussed about that a lot with friends years ago, and I also agree, or I would like to put it in those words, I think programming is not recognized as a fine craft, right? So, but I also would like to add that for me, when I program, I am guided by theory, by mathematics, and so on. And when I program, it is that I model something, I produce some content, code that does something. I solve problems, right? So what I actually do is basically turning the solution of a problem where I require math into code. And what is missing is this, the last mile, the coding craft. And there I totally agree. And also at university level, I think programming is, there is a too less emphasis on the importance on the craft programming.
Totally agree. Let's put it in broader social terms. The social status, I come out of the Maschinenbau Fakultät at Stanford, mechanical engineering. Europe, Germany, Austria are Maschinenbau Arbeitskulturen. So Maschinenbau, you know, has the highest status, Elektrotechnik. The reason the term is software Entwickler is used is because they are not considered to have the same status as engineers. We need to start talking about software engineers, producing software engineers, not coders, not Entwickler, okay, because we need to give these people the same social status, the same status inside industry, inside Familienunternehmen, as the Maschinenbau engineer and the Elektrotechniker. So this requires a big change, and this, George, is where I depart. I do not agree that the European model is working here, because the European model is really based on this mechanical engineering culture. This is where we need to move closer to software culture, software and data centric.
I think you are, of course, right and wrong at the same point in time. I want to mention the wrong part because to have a little controversy here. Yeah. So we have Benneke and Rainer here, BNR. How many people in this room know BNR? Yeah? It's one of the leading companies in the world in terms of control systems, and they are really doing software engineering at a very high level. The Tool Suite Automation Studio from BNR is setting a benchmark in software tooling and software programming. Yeah, it's an Austrian company. It's not that well known. They make the money still with hardware, yeah, and we are going to change that in the future. But this is the way how our kind of industry works. They pay for hardware. But basically what those companies do, they have excellent software engineers, and they are influencing global standards. And I can just give you an example. Both GTEC and BNR, we are cooperating in the Industrial Internet Consortium in the US with companies like Bosch Rexroth and Schneider and KUKA, and they are all European companies and doing the manufacturing testbed, mainly basically software-based systems. So it's about OPC UA, about OPC UA over IEEE TSN. This is all kind of software and networking. And I think, yes, we need to improve in Europe. I'm not saying everything is perfect, but don't underestimate the software engineers in the European companies. There has been tremendous progress made in the last 20 years. If you look at the auto industry, if you look at certain other industries, there are very good software engineers.
Yeah. May I add something? Or I not totally agree. Of course, we have a good basis, but we are still selling hardware. We are still selling hardware. Yes. And this is the big difference between the US companies, because they are selling solutions. And that's the big gap we have in Europe. We have to match, so that we create business models and thinking about business models by software, and not just calculating a product and the software is for free. So I draw a bit black white, but I think this is really the issue we have to deal with.
I agree, and I'm not saying it's about selling at a business model. I'm just saying about the capabilities in the companies, that there are very good software engineers in the companies, but they are not coming through yet.
Yes, yes.
I say that does not produce good software engineers. No.
Okay, before somebody's beaten up. I would like to go to the closing remarks to be on the absolutely safe side. Georg, looking at the time, do you take microphone and maybe we continue the discussions, lively discussions afterwards when okay. Georg did the closing remarks. Georg, please.
I'm a little bit afraid of standing here. No. Well, I'm really impressed with what has with the discussion tonight, especially with the individual ones here on the individual tables. I think what we're trying to do here is three things at IST Austria, besides really excellent basic science, and that's on the one hand also bringing that basic excellent science into applications. And what you said, for example, it really impressed me, Bernd, that you said, thinking about it, I can't think of a problem, of a fundamental problem that wouldn't have some kind of application. And that's exactly what it takes. You put a few smart people into a room, let them think, and they will come up with solutions to fundamental problems that will have applications afterwards. It's also very important, as you said, to build, Georg Koppetz, to build a bridge to industry, to let people go that don't follow an academic career into an industrial career. And we've seen these three very smart young men over there. Unfortunately, we didn't have a woman, but I'm sure we will have one soon. And they have gone into industry, and that's exactly what it takes. You need excellent scientific background that you can then apply in in industry. And by the way, we're also building a bridge actually over to the technology park, so the entire thing will be a bridge. The last thing that you need is obviously an ecosystem where companies from outside and from inside IST Austria can thrive. And there we've seen three cases here. I'm getting a little bit worried about their growth plans because they still are on campus and we don't have that much space, so we really have to build that technology park very, very soon. And we might even have to expand it already. But just to sum it up, I think the most important thing tonight was to show that if you have an ecosystem where a lot of smart people can sit down and follow their passion, be it in fundamental science or translation into industry and then actually making products to sell them, everything will be good. So I hope the buffet will be good as well, and I wish you a very successful networking evening still. Thank you very much for coming. And thank you to the panelists.